Bonjour. On m'a confié la tâche de vous présenter Guillaume Hébrard. Alors évidemment, j'imagine que beaucoup d'entre vous ici le connaissent déjà, mais je vais rappeler quelques éléments de sa biographie. Tout d'abord, Guillaume a soutenu sa thèse ici à l'IAP, sous la direction d'Alfred Vidal-Majar, où il travaillait sur les observations du milieu interstellaire, en particulier du milieu interstellaire local. Et déjà, dès sa thèse, Guillaume avait fait la découverte de raies d'émission, de fluorescence du deutérium, ce qui avait permis de faire des observations extrêmement originales du deutérium. Comme vous le savez sans doute, extrêmement important, le ratio D sur H étant un traceur de la nucléosynthèse primordiale. Après cette thèse, Guillaume a fait un postdoctorat à CNES pour travailler sur FUSE, qui est le satellite de NASA auquel le CNES participait, avec Alfred Vidal-Majar comme co-PI. Et donc nous étions ici très impliqués sur cette mission FUSE. Et donc Guillaume a énormément travaillé sur cette mission. Il a aussi effectué un séjour de 2 ans à Johns Hopkins à Baltimore pour travailler sur FUSE. Et ces observations de FUSE ont donné plein de résultats, mais je vais citer un des résultats que Guillaume a conduit, qui est la mesure du rapport deutérium sur oxygène dans la bulle locale, qui a permis de répondre à une question de variabilité de ce rapport D sur H dans la bulle locale. Et Guillaume a donc démontré que ce rapport était constant à l'intérieur de la bulle locale, qui est extrêmement important, donc, comme je rappelais, pour les mesures de rapport D sur H et dans le milieu interstellaire local. Enfin, Guillaume est devenu après chercheur à plein temps à l'IAP et il a mis son expertise de la spectroscopie au service de l'observation des exoplanètes, donc un peu un changement de thématique, mais en conservant la spectroscopie comme moyen d'observation. Et j'ai noté 2 résultats majeurs obtenus sur ces années, qui sont d'abord la découverte d'évaporation des Jupiters chauds, la découverte à laquelle tu as participé, parce qu'on utilise la spectroscopie pour observer les atmosphères d'exoplanètes, mais aussi pour découvrir des exoplanètes, je pense que c'est dont tu vas nous parler là. Et enfin, un dernier résultat, je ne sais pas si tu vas nous en parler, parce que c'est un résultat qu'il a obtenu avec les observations à l'OHP, de la première découverte, en fait c'est Guillaume qui est le premier à mesurer des angles d'orientation des plans des exoplanètes qui étaient non alignés avec l'axe de rotation de l'étoile. Et cette découverte a eu des conséquences, elle a été confirmée par la suite pour d'autres systèmes, et ça a eu d'énormes conséquences pour les mécanismes de formation des planètes. Voilà. Donc je laisse la parole, et donc je laisse la parole. Parler de l'OHP.
Merci Alain, thank you. So I suppose it's better in English? No? Maybe when you hear my English, you will change your mind, I don't know, we'll see. So I'm very happy to be here, and I thank the organizers of the seminar to propose me to give a talk here at IAP, of course, an institute which is very dear for I. So I will talk about research and characterization of exoplanets with Sophie at Observatoire d'Haute-Provence. So first, for people who don't know well, Observatoire d'Haute-Provence. Observatoire d'Haute-Provence is located here in the south of France. And there are several telescopes, facilities at that observatory, and in particular, the 193 centimeter telescope, which is the largest on the site, that we use for extrasolar planet detection and studies. And maybe first, an historical point of view. When you go to the IAP white page, you can see a word on the arrêté of October 13, 1936. And it is very important, actually, because if you read that, it is in French. At that time, it was in French. It created, at that time, so back in 36, two organisms. One, an observation station located in Haute-Provence, and another, a lab preferentially in Paris to analyze the data obtained in Haute-Provence. And of course, I suppose you know that station in Haute-Provence later became Observatoire d'Haute-Provence, and that laboratory preferentially in Paris became Institut d'Astrophysique de Paris, our our institute here, so both OHP and IIP are deeply linked for that time. The people who take care of that doesn't work, so I will use that. Who take care of that, it was Jean Perrin, Nobel Prize. A lot of other Nobel Prizes created these two organisms. A lot of people famous in the IIP history, Mineur, Challonge, Danjon. That this institute were coordinated by services de recherche d'astrophysique rattachés à Caisse nationale de recherche scientifique, who a few years later became CNRS, of course an institution that we know very well now. It was led by the sous-secrétaire d'État à la recherche scientifique, who was Jean Perrin at that time, and that text was signed by Jean Zay, who we know here, a very famous people, who is, since a few years now, his grave is in Panthéon, just nearby here. So you see that at that time there was a close collaboration between the politician and researcher for a lot of great decisions, I think. And you can see also that OHP and IIP have a long common stories still right now, because today there is Michel Denfeld, Henry McCracken, I think Carrie Benabed also, who right now are at OHP to teach observation in astronomy to students. And of course, we continue to do research programs in collaboration between OHP and IIP in exoplanetary science. So I will talk today about exoplanetary science. So first, why searching and studying extrasolar planets? The first goal is to explore the universe diversity. We know the planets of the solar system, but there are other planets, so the first goal is to explore their diversity, what we can find in our universe. Detect and study particular systems. There are a lot of discoveries that were made in extrasolar planet research, but there are a lot of discoveries that are still to be done in the following years. Determine the statistical property of planets. So by looking huge samples of stars, we can detect a lot of planets and have a vision of their statistical properties. And it's not easy because all the methods, I will talk a little bit about that, have their own biases. So we have to correct from these biases to try to understand what are the properties of planets. One of the goals of exoplanetary science also is to constrain models of formation and evolution of planetary systems and to compare their prediction with the statistical properties that we obtain from the observation. Of course, also, one of the goals is to discover Earth twins, because this is, of course, a great challenge to try to detect and to study planets that are similar to our planets, with that long-term goal, which is to provide inputs for exobiology, because this is one of the cases to study extrasolar planets, to try maybe one day to discover and study extraterrestrial life. So to that goal, there are a lot of steps, of course, and the method I will talk today is the radial velocity method, which is an indirect method to detect and study extrasolar planets. The simplest method to detect them is the direct method by imaging, direct imaging, when you obtain a picture of a star and a planet located just nearby. But there are some detection now, but it is a very difficult as method. And so the indirect method uses the fact that the planet is orbiting around the star. We don't see the planet, but we can see the reflex motion of the star due to the gravitational interaction with the planets. And by Doppler measurements, detect the radial velocity of the star. And if there is a variability, a periodic variability of the radial velocity of the star, we can conclude there is a planet orbiting the star. So usually the observations, the data we obtain, are the radial velocity of the star as a function of the time. And here, in this case, you have the point here and the Keplerian model when we have oscillation like that. So the star is receding, approaching periodically. We can conclude there is a body orbiting the star. And if we measure the mass, we can conclude this is a planet. If we fast fold such kind of curve, we have the radial velocity as a function of the orbital phase. With such kind of curves, we can constrain the planet we detect. And so the radial velocity provides the planetary mass actually the minimum planetary mass because there is a projection effect. In most of the cases, we don't know the inclination of the orbital plane, so what we measure is the minimum mass. We can measure the orbital period and the eccentricity. So we see that when we have such kind of curve, with the amplitude of that radial velocity measurement, the amplitude which is the letter k here, which depends on the mass of the planet, the inclination of the orbit, the mass of the star, the orbital period, and the eccentricity of the orbit. Using some simplification, we have that that formula, which gives order of magnitude. And so if we use that with the order of magnitude for a hot Jupiter, so a Jupiter mass planet orbiting its stars in a few days, we have variation of roughly 100 meters per second on a time scale of a few days. If we have a Jupiter type planet, we have a variation with an amplitude of plus or minus 12 meters per second with a period of 12 years. And if we look for Earth planets, the amplitude will be plus or minus 9 centimeters per second with a period, of course, of 1 year. So this gives order of magnitude both on the radial velocity amplitude we should detect and the time scale on which we should observe and be accurate enough to detect such kind of variations. And of course, the first planet detected using this method was 51 Peg B in 95 by Mayer and Queloz, using LOD, the spectrograph at the 193 telescope at OHP, which was installed before SOFIE. So it was a planet with just a 4-day period, such kind of radial velocity amplitude, a mass of half a mass of Jupiter. And so here on the artistic view, a Jupiter very near its star, a few days orbits, so a very hot planet. Right after that one, it was the planet detected by the American colleagues. So you see that the radial velocity as a function of the time. Here, this is a long period planet, 3 years period. We see all the measurements they obtain, and starting in 95, of course, they observe a lot because we knew at that time that that technique was working with a greater accuracy because they devote a lot of work to improve their instrumentation. Another interesting system that was obtained in these early days of exoplanets was that one around Epsilon Andromeda. So a hot Jupiter was detected, so a few day period with about a Jupiter mass for the body. But in a residual of the Keplerian fit to, from the data, we can see two other variations. You see the point here, a variation here, and another at higher frequency. So it was the first multiple system detected. So with planet B, a hot Jupiter, and planet C and D, radial velocity, of course, allow also to detect multiple systems, and you combine the radial velocity variation of the different companions. Radial velocity also provides the eccentricity. If you have a circular orbit, you will have a very regular sinusoid, whereas if you have an eccentric orbit, the radial velocity will have strong variations. For example, here with such kind of eccentricity, or this case, which is the most eccentric planet known today, with such kind of eccentricity, we see the variation of the radial velocity, a strong variation which is near the star, and after a deeper, smoother variation. One of the important parameters in radial velocity, of course, is the accuracy you can reach on the amplitude of the variation. And here you can see the velocity semi-amplitude as a function of the year of the detection of the planets. And what we see is that it decreases with time, which means that we are able to have more and more accurate instruments and lower and lower masses for the planets. Actually, it's not quite sure that it continued to decrease. You know, it decreased clearly up to 2010, 2011. After it's unclear, maybe there is, clearly there is a difficulty here, which is linked to the stellar activity. I will talk about that, the stellar magnetic cycle, something like that. But clearly, we need to improve the accuracy of the radial measurements in order to detect lower mass planets and longer period planets. So the key points to improve the radial velocity accuracy, it first to have an accurate wavelength calibration on short and long time scales. So there are several techniques used for that. absorption cells, holocathode lamps, Fabry Pyrrho interferometer, laser combs. So a lot of these techniques are used. You need high spectral resolution. You need a very good instrument stability, again, on short and long time scales. So for that, most of the instruments are regulated in temperature, in pressure. Some of them are put in a vacuum vessel in order to be very stable over the time. You need to, I will talk also about that, to take care about the injection accuracy, the injection of the light of the star within the spectrograph, the scrambling, the guiding on the of the telescope. You need also to be able to do spectral diagnosis on the star itself, because there are a lot of radiovelocity signals that can be produced by stellar activity, by the rotation of the star. So if you can diagnose that, it will help you to disentangle such kind of signal from the planet themselves. And you need a large number of measurements and good quality data, high signal to noise ratio. So really, such kind of programs are very consuming in terms of observing night. So there are numerous radiovelocity instruments over the world doing such kind of measurements. So I give a list here, which is not exhaustive. And I will talk today about the SOFI spectrograph at Observatoire de Provence. So here you can see the instrument, SOFI. So this is a cross-dispersed Echelle spectrograph working in the optical domain. It is environmentally stabilized in that vessel, and even more in that second vessel, which is very stable in temperature and pressure. I will give you some order of magnitude later. So the dispersive elements are inside the tank here. It's fed by optical fiber, calibrated with holocathode lamps or Fabry-Pyrrho. So a few modes of observation, I will switch that. The first light was obtained in 2006 at that telescope. And since then, we did several upgrades on the instrument, mainly in 2010, 2012, and 2014, 2017. I'll talk to you about the importance to be stabilized in temperature. So you see the four steps here of the instruments. We can see them before the instrument was located at OHP. So in that containers, which is regulated in temperature. So there are several steps of stabilization in temperature, in pressure, and pressure. The result we can see here in pressure. Here, this is the atmospheric pressure as a function of the time. And here, the pressure within the instrument. And the same for the temperature. Here, variation of temperature in different parts, and in blue, the temperature inside the instrument itself. In 2011, we made a very significant improvement of the instrument by putting octagonal section fiber on the spectrograph. Actually, it was the first spectrograph in the world to have such kind of equipment, octagonal section fiber, to put the light from the telescope to the spectrograph. Few other ones used that technique after. And why we did that? Actually, it's to improve the scrambling of the lights of the star within the spectrograph. Here you have a section of the fiber octagonal. This is very uniform. And before, we have a circular section optical fiber. And here you have homogeneities of the lights of the star. And with that, when you have issue with the guiding of the telescope, which of course is not perfect, variation of the seeing, which could vary also, such kind of homogeneities will produce effect in radiovelocities measured from the spectrograph. So it was a strong limitation of SOFI before that, before 2011. And with octagonal section, the scrambling is clearly better. So some comparison here. Here, the radiovelocity curve as a function of the orbital phase. For that, this planet, which was our star planet, which was already known. So with SOFI before the octagonal section, we can see the dispersion in black and the residual. And in red, what we call SOFI plus, which means after we put the octagonal section of the fiber, we see a better accuracy, which has kind of dispersion. Another example here, when we reach 1 meter per second accuracy, on that case, you see the radial velocity variation and the residual from the Keplerian fit. So it was a very significant improvement of SOFI at that time. We also improved by put a new calibration unit with all this lamp for the calibration that we can see on the other way here, the lamp and the trolley that put the light from the calibration lamps and put them in the spectrograph for the calibration. Such kind of equipment was also realized for Spirou, the spectrograph which is installed right now at CFHT, the new one. We do the calibration now with Fabry Perot. So to give you a picture, an idea of a spectra, here is a 2D picture of a calibration lamp observation. And if you look, we see the emission of the lamp, which with different distances between lines and different flux of the line, so it's not homogeneous. If we use a Fabry-Perot, we can see here the Fabry-Perot, it's homogeneous. We have a very regular distances between the different lines, very homogeneous in flux, so we obtain a better calibration. The way we measure the radial velocity, we use the cross-correlation techniques. So we start from the 2D picture of the spectra. We obtain a 1D with thousands of lines on that spectral range. We cross-correlate that 1D spectra with numerical mask typical of the star we observe, and the result is the cross-correlation function. So the intensity of the cross-correlation function as a function of the radial velocity, which can we can see that as a kind of average of the thousands of spectral lines that we detect in the star. So as we have thousands of lines, we have a very good accuracy. And so from that, by fitting such kind the CCF, we obtain the radial velocity measurement. To give order of magnitude, the width of such kind of line, it's a few kilometers per second, and we are able to measure the position in the radial velocity space with an accuracy of 1-2 meters per second. With that technique, we can also obtain a lot of information of the line, the bisector, with quantify the shape of the line, the width, the rotation of the star, the metallicity of the star. That technique is very powerful to obtain information of the radial velocity also, of course, but other parameters from the star. So using that, we perform a huge survey of stars to detect and characterize extrasolar planets. So this is a large program which is called the SOFI-RPE Consortium with all this, with collaborators right now, with Isabelle Bois as a PI. It's implied 6 institutes, including IAP and OHP. Several sub-programs are made among that large collaboration with a significant number of nights per year. That large number of nights allow us to have a good flexibility in scheduling the observation, to be reactive when there is a new detection, new discoveries, to follow and optimize the instrument, as I just showed you before. And so I will give you now a review of some of the results we obtain with this program. So the first large program we do as part of that collaboration is a survey for giant planets. And so Shweta Dalal in thesis here is working on that. So it's an example of the star selection we made to study, to detect a giant planet. So we look solar type stars. Right now we have about 2,000 stars that we follow to detect and characterize planet, giant planets. Here we have the HR diagram of the star we selected for that. The typical accuracy we have for that survey for giant planets is shown by that histogram, which is an histogram of the dispersion of the radial velocity measurement for each star. So before the implementation of the octagonal section fiber, we have that histogram with a typical accuracy of slightly below 10 meters per second, which was not good enough for such kind of measurements. And since SOFI Plus in 2011, now the histogram peaks around 4 meters per second. So this is the accuracy we have with this survey. Here we have an histogram of the distribution of the mass, or the minimum masses of the known extrasolar planets. And we see there are two peaks, the low mass planets and the large mass planets, so the giant planets. So this is here that we are looking for that survey at 4 meters per second accuracy. And so some results I can show you, for example, by Isabelle Bois et al. She obtained that during her PhD thesis here at IAP. Around that star, which is very famous to host a transiting planet, we have the radial velocity curve of that star here. That star is particularly active. We can quantify the activity by looking in the calcium line. When we have strong chromospheric emission of calcium line, we can conclude this is an active star and quantify that. And such kind of activity will produce radial velocity signal in addition to the radial velocity signal due to the planets. And by studying such kind of correlation, by example, between the bisector and the radial velocity, we can correct that and quantify to about 8 meters per second the noise due to the activity of the star. Another example is the detection of that multiple system with two planets orbiting around that star. We have the radial velocity curve here as a function of the time with two periods detected. Here, the fast folded curves of both planets with 30 days and almost 200 days period. Here, this is an active star, so we have a dispersion of 15 meters per second because in addition to the accuracy of the instrument, which is about 4 meters per second, we have the signal due to the stellar activity. So when we have points in red here, the radial velocity measurement obtained like that, is not trivial to obtain the period. So some of the techniques we use as a periodogram, for example, Lomb-Scargell periodogram. Here, you have the periodogram of the radial velocities of that star, and we see two peaks here with the two periods of the planet, but there are other peaks, other signals. So we analyze such kind of periodogram to detect the planet, to study the aliases, the harmonic of the signal. There are also periodic signal or quasi-periodic signal due to the activity of the star. We can find something like that. The residual when we remove just the inner planet, the residual when we remove just the outer planet, and here's the residual after removing both planets, and we have the order of magnitude of the accuracy we can have here. Some other example, detection of hot Jupiters in multiple systems. Actually, most of the hot Jupiters, so Jupiter mass planets orbiting in a few days around their star, most of them are single planets, they have no companion. And we know that hot Jupiter were not formed at their current location. They were formed far from the star, then through migration, they go nearby their star. But there are some examples when we find companions in addition to the hot Jupiter. So there are halo studies to be made for about the interaction between planets, which could be responsible in partially about the migration. So here an example, another example here, we see the hot Jupiter at high frequency and we see another planet detected here in that system. Another system of multiple planets in interaction here in that system, again two planets detected with such kind of period, which is just outside the 12-5 resonance, which is the ratio between the period of the inner planet and the period of the outer planet. So we do that in collaboration with our colleague Jacques Lasca and collaborators at Observatoire de Paris. And they were able to compute that there is a precession of the orientation of the orbit of both planets with such kind of period. Here the variation of the orientation, the relative orientations of both planets, and here the variation with the same 206-year period of the variation of their eccentricities. If we look at the histograms of the orbital period considering just giant planets, so more massive than 20% of Jupiter mass, we clearly see a bimodal distribution with a short period planets and longer period planets. So here they are the hot Jupiter, and here they are planets more like our Jupiter in our solar system, with period of a few hundred days to a few years, few tens years. And there is a valley here, a lack of planet detection is not an observing bias, because of course these planets are easier to detect than this one. So this is the signature of formation and evolution of planetary system. The planets form rather here, and some of them migrate to inside the planetary system. And so we study also that domain with SOFIE, and so to do that we need long-term observations, but we detect also long period planets, giant planets. Here an example with three-year period planets, other example with a long period here, even 10 years planets. So they are interesting. It is interesting to detect such kind of planets because they are more or less as similar to the Jupiter, the Saturn planets in our solar system. And they also allow to investigate the question of habitability. There is what we call the habitable zone, which is the distance to the star, which is not too near the star, and so it's not too hot, and the water would evaporate, and not too far from the star, where it will be too cold, and the water will be on ice. So there is a good distance when we can have liquid water. And so, for example, for that planet, here is the orbit of the planet from above, the star here and the planet. And in green and red, the habitable zone, considering several different hypotheses. And so this planet is in the habitable zone. So that planet, of course, is not habitable because this is a giant planet. But we can consider that it is possible such kind of planet is orbited by satellites. So, for example, if there is a Titan-like satellite orbiting that planet, it could be habitable. In terms of long period companion, we also detect very massive companion. Here you see the mass is a few tenths of Jupiter masses. So clearly, here there are not planets. They are brown dwarfs, so a long period, some example. Here even a period of more than 100 years. One study obtained on that subject by Rodrigo Diaz when he was postdoc here at IAP. Here there are some detection of several massive companions with a SOFI, so some in a planet mass range, some in a brown dwarf, some on star. And I will talk about that one because that one was interesting because when we do the cross-correlation, we use, so I told you, numerical mask, which is representative of given a stellar type. And so here in that case, when we use different kind of mask for a K5 star or an M4 star, we find significantly different amplitude for the variation. So how we interpret that? We interpret that actually there is not just one star, this is a binary star, and you have the two sets of spectral lines. So the CCF actually is not just one CCF, but two CCF, which are not resolved. They are too nearby each from them. They move a little bit one by comparison to the other one. And if the stars are not from the same spectral type, they give different results when we measure the variation of the radial velocity. So this is a sign that actually here, we do not detect a low mass for a star, for a planet, 49 Jupiter masses. Of course, it's very large, but if this is a star, it's very low. So this is a sign, as we find different values here, that here actually what we observe is a binary star. And another sign is obtained by the study of the bisector. We see here the bisector as a function of the radial velocity. The bisector is the shape of the line. So we see that the shape of the line does vary in a correlated way with the radial velocity. If this is just the variation of the radial velocity, the bisector should not vary. As it varies, that means that the CCF, the cross-correlation function, change shapes. And so if it changes shape, it means that actually there are two CCF moving one by comparison to the other one, but it's not resolved. So Rodrigo Diaz tried to modelize such kind of variation of the bisector with the radial velocity, with different hypotheses, free parameter on the mass of the secondary, of the width of the line of the secondary. And he obtained a minimum here, a detection, which allowed him to conclude that the mass of the secondary was between 0.35 and 0.45 solar masses, which is clearly more massive than the minimum mass, the sky projected mass that was obtained from radial velocity, which means that we see that system nearly face on from above. So what we see in radial velocity have a small amplitude, but actually the motion is larger. And we can try to detect that by looking astrometry. So we use with Johannes Salman, the Hipparcos astrometric measurement, and we detect, it's not a high significance, but it's detected, the variations. This is the position of the star on the sky, some astrometric variation, and from that motion, it was possible to measure the mass of the secondary, and that mass, so measured from astrometry, agree with the mass detected from radial velocity and correlation with bisector, which is a good sign to validate such kind of modelizations that were made by Rodrigo Diaz at that time. Such kind of analyses are very important in considering the transiting planets. I will talk about that later, because the blend issue is very important for transiting planets. When we see a planet transiting in front of a star, sometimes it is not really a planet. This is a blend of binary star blended with the light of another star, and such kind of 2D are very useful to try to resolve such cases. Other results obtained with SOFIE on radial velocity, so on large mass objects, by Paul Wilson, again when he was postdoc here at IAP. Here's some in yellow the system he detected with SOFIE with his work, and there will be a lot of new detection soon published by Flavien Kiefer, who should be here, I suppose. Yes, we will soon publish a lot of new detection with SOFIE. Here I show you the distribution of known planets, their mass as a function of the orbital period. So we have the two populations of giant planets at short period and long period, as I present you before. And there is, of course, also the population of low mass planets, which I already show you in that histogram. This is this population. We also study that population with SOFIE, but of course, to do that, we need a higher accuracy in radial velocity because the mass of the planet are smaller. So to do that, why we try to we continue to develop the SOFIE spectrograph, because at the beginning of SOFIE, its accuracy was not good enough to reach and to study that domain. And still, after the improvement of the SOFIE spectrograph, we still find that there are some variation, instrumental variation, that we did not understood well. Probably they are linked to a thermal effect in the spectrograph. So we try to reduce that, to reduce them. We succeed partially, but not totally. So still, to deal with low mass planets, we follow a lot of standard stars in order to be able to quantify and the instrumental drift on the instrument and to correct for it. So here is the result obtained by Bastien Courcol and collaborator. So this is the radial velocity instrumental drift of the instrument as a function of the time. So you see this is significant. This is a few meters per second variation. So if you want to detect low mass planets, you need to correct for that. And so by correcting for that, we are able to obtain very good accuracy. If here you see radial velocity as a function of the time over 3 years with that accuracy below 2 meters per second. We test the accuracy of SOFIE on known cases. So here is a planetary system with a low mass detected with Kepler here in blue and with SOFIE here in red. And the value you obtain for SOFIE without and with drift correction, the dispersion was improved. You see we are around 2 meters per second accuracy. And if we compare with what was obtained with IRES, we see with SOFIE was slightly better, so it's similar. So that means that with a 2 meter telescope on bright stars, we can be as accurate as a spectrograph installed on a 10 meter telescope, on bright stars, of course. So if we do, as I showed you before, the histogram of the dispersion, we see that SOFIE Plus, with the correction, we have an accuracy of about 2 meters per second by comparison with the 4 meters per second accuracy that I showed you before for the moderate accuracy survey. And so with that, we are able to detect some low mass planets. So an example is here with that planet with that small variation. You see it's a few meters per second amplitude variation with the parameter of that planet detected here. We do such kind of observation also on exoplanets orbiting M-dwarf. So we have a seminar last month by Xavier Bonfils about the planets around M-dwarf, so I won't recall what he said. I just took a slide from his talk from last month. So look for planets around M-dwarf is interesting because there are stars with a small mass, smaller radii, so that allow to detect, it's favorable to detect low mass planets, small side planets, and cooler planets. So we do that also with SOFIE in the optical, and here is one of the detection we obtain, the radial velocity as a function of the time. Here, the periodogram is more complicated. There are a lot of signals in such kind of observation, but there is a planetary signal here. We check this is not a signal due to the stellar activity, for example, by looking in H-alpha, the periodicity we find. So we see here a signature of stellar activity, probably linked to the rotation of the star. again with our colleague from Paris Observatory, they developed a new way to construct such kind of periodogram with a different method, and the peak of the planet is detected here. So the phase folded curve looks like that. So we have a detection of a planet with about a Neptune mass planet with about 100-day orbital period. So now, to give an overview of the radial survey we did with Sophie, we have about 4 new exoplanets detected, including the interacting system, long period, Neptune mass, M dwarf hosts, and a dozen of new ones are expected to be soon announced. We detect also about 40 new massive companions, including a dozen on brown dwarf, and with the paper of Flavien, there will be a tenth of new ones soon announced. And now to finish my seminar, I will talk about transiting exoplanets. So this is a different technique. When the planet transits in front of the star, we can detect it with photometry. Transiting planets are very good systems because they allow planetary radii to be measured. If you have the mass measurement from radii velocity, you have the density, so you can study the structure of the planet. We can do atmospheric absorption during transit. We did that. We do that at IAP also to study the atmosphere of the planet. We can study also emitted light thanks to occultation. When the planet goes behind the star by comparison, we can detect the light emitted by the planet. We can do a variation of the timing because the transit gives very accurate values for the orbital period. So if there are variations of the period, you can conclude that there are interactions between planets. We can also do obliquity measurement. Maybe I'll talk at the end about that. I'm not sure I will have time. So as transiting planets are very good objects to study, they provide a lot of information. There are a lot of surveys, photometric surveys, to try to detect planetary transit. So there are ground-based surveys and space-based surveys. And all these surveys need a radial velocity follow-up. So the first goal of the radial velocity surveys of this program is to establish the nature of the transiting events. Because indeed, when we have a photometric survey for a transiting planet, you have a lot of candidates like that. So see, this is photometry with possible decrease in a light curve of the star, which could be the signature of the planet transiting in front of the star. But such kind of light curve could be due to grazing eclipsing binary, when you have a star just grazing the star, another star grazing the primary star. So you have a transit which is not very deep. You can have eclipsing M dwarf, so small size star. You can have background eclipsing binaries. We can have blending eclipsing binaries. I talked to you about blend previously. So all these scenarios are very common to produce light curve, which look as planetary transit, but actually are not. And of course, in some cases, this is due to the transiting planets. So we can resolve these cases with radial velocities. So the first goal is, and yes, an order of magnitude from the ground-based surveys for transiting planets in photometry, the efficiency is very low. Actually, in such kind of surveys from the ground, only 1 to 10% of the candidates finally are due to planets. Most of them are not due to planets, but are due to binary stars in bladed scenarios. So the first goal of the radial velocity is to establish that a candidate actually is a planet or not. When you know it is a planet, radial velocity allows the mass of the planet to be measured. They allow the eccentricity to be measured. Spectroscopy also allows the parameter of the host star to be determined, and a lot of other measurements could be done. And so with Sophie, yes, we do a lot of radial velocity follow-up of transiting program, of a transit photometric survey for transiting planets. We do that since 2006, since the beginning of Sophie. So we have the equivalent of about 70 nights per year for such kind of program. And so the first results we obtained were in collaboration with colleagues from SuperOAS. So SuperOAS is this instrument. We survey in photometry a huge number of stars to try to detect transits in their light curve. So the first planet with Sophie were detected a few weeks after Sophie was installed at OHP. And since then, with WASP and Sophie, we detect tens of planets using this technique. Now we have more than 50 planets detected with that. We collaborate also with the other program, the HAT program, which is another program which survey in photometry stars to detect transits. We do that with other program. I will give you all this program from the ground, mainly they detect hot Jupiters, but we find also some different planets. For example, a planet like that with a quite long period for a hot Jupiter, some planets which are inflated planets with a large radii. Such kind of large radii are not easy to explain with a model of internal structure. Some very diverse planets, for example, this example, two planets, WASP-1-13 and 1-14, which are about the same radius, similar period, but very different masses, so very different density, as you can see, so huge diversity also in hot Jupiters. An example here of significant eccentricity detected. Most of the hot Jupiters are on circular orbits because the orbits were circularized by tidal interaction between the star and the planet, but there are some cases where it is not the case. And maybe as a last example, that planet WASP-12, which is one of the most studies in the literature, because it is particularly hot. This is probably one of the hottest planets detected so far, which is favorable for atmospheric studies because the scale I will be large on that planet. And also here in that plot, we see the decreasing of the orbital period. The orbital period of that planet decreases with time, which is the signature of additional bodies in that system. We do that also from space-based surveys. Of course, we did that for Corot. So the first planet discovered by Corot. Ah. So I have to restart from the beginning, maybe not. So about Corot, yes. Sophie, so just let me a few seconds. Okay, so the first planet detected with Corot was characterized with Sophie. It was a hot Jupiter. With Corot, Sophie was used to detect a lot of hot Jupiter, also some brown dwarf. It was used also to detect planets at slightly longer period because from the ground you can detect longer period. From the space you can detect longer period. From ground it's difficult to detect long period transiting planets because you have the night and day succession, which make that difficult. And also we use Sophie to make a first selection of a longer period planet as a coronite, which is a Jupiter with a 3 months orbit, or low mass planet as a Corot 7, which was first characterized with Sophie. We did that also with Kepler. So Kepler, I suppose you know about that mission from NASA, which was like Corot, but with better accuracy for the photometry, and with a longer sequence of observation. Kepler did observe for 4 years exactly the same star, so it was powerful to detect long period transiting planets. So we detect a lot of planets with Sophie and Kepler. The first from outside the Kepler team was obtained with Sophie. So some example here of the planet detected by Kepler, candidate detected by Kepler and characterized with Sophie. In some cases also, Sophie was not accurate enough to detect the planet, so we use Sophie to do a first selection of objects. Then we switch on the ARPS North, new spectrograph that was installed a few years ago in Canary Island, which is more accurate and with a larger telescope than Sophie. So in this example, we see in red the measurement made with Sophie, which did not allow the detection to be made, but with ARPS North, we are able to detect the planets. I will switch that and go to that histogram. I show you already that histogram of the number of known planets as a function of their mass. So with the two populations, the low mass planets and the giant planets. In black, there are the whole population of the planets, and in red, there are just the transiting planets. We see that we detect both populations also in transiting planets. And if we take just the massive planets, the giant planets, and we look at the bimodal distribution of the period, as I showed you before with the valley here, with the period between 10 and 100 days, and we plot the same for the transiting planets here, we don't have the same population detected with transiting planets. So of course, this is observing bias, because these long period planets are difficult to detect in transits, because transits are very not frequent when the period is long, and the probability to have a transit is lower also. So this is a high interest to detect such kind of transiting planet with long period, because they allow all the study I was talking about before. So with Sophie, we can characterize some longer period planet with Kepler. For example, that one, the Kepler-like curve and the Sophie-like curve with an orbit of 1 month and a half. Another with an orbit of 3 months here. You see that we follow during several years with Sophie. And one that we recently announced, that new planet with a very long period for transiting planet. This is one of the longest period for a transiting planet known to date. We see here the Kepler-like curve with the transit detected each 5 or 6 months, and the radial velocity follow-up we did with Sophie. So the equivalent temperature of such kind of planet is lower, of course, when compared with a hot Jupiter. It was 1,000 degrees for Jupiter. It's clear it's more similar to what we have on the Earth or maybe on Jupiter and Saturn. Here, the distribution of the mass of transiting planet as a function of the orbital period. So as I show you, there are very few transiting planets at long orbital period. And when we have the transit of the planet, you have the mass, you have the radius, so you have the density. And here you have the density of the planet as a function of the equilibrium temperature of the planet. And of course, we see that we have a lot of planets here at a large temperature. Not a lot here by comparison, this is Jupiter and Saturn. And something interesting to see in such kind of a graph, it's the lower envelope here, which is increasing in that direction. That means that when you are near the star, you have hotter planets, and here you can have very low density planets, whereas when you are far from the star, the temperature is lower, and you don't have such a low density of the star, which is, well, we can understand that well, as in terms of interaction between the star which hits the planet atmosphere. I will switch that, and yes, time is running, so I will switch. No, I will talk about that. We detect also with Sophie, we characterize Kepler objects which were not planets but were massive companions, brown dwarf or even binary star. So we see example here with a large mass object. So it looks like a planet in a Kepler-like curve, but actually when we do the radial velocity, we see that the mass is very huge. And we have a lot of cases like that, which clearly are not planets. You see they are in the brown dwarf regime. And so we try to quantify the number of true planets within the Kepler candidate and the number of Kepler objects which actually are not planets. So to do that, we selected a homogeneous sample of Kepler candidates, and we observed it systematically with Sophie, and we find a false positive rate of about 55%. So that means that it's only for the candidate corresponding to giant planets. That means that in the Kepler candidate, actually, just half of them actually are planets. The other half are not planets, they are binary stars or something like that. So doing that, we can compute the occurrence of planets free for false positives. And the value you obtain, it's about 5%. So about 5% of stars have giant planets. And we go up to the period of 400 days. We complete up to that. And we can also obtain the distribution of orbital period of giant planets. And we did, it was known already from radial velocity. I show you that there is a peak with the hot Jupiters and another peak with long period planets. And between 10 days and 100 days period, there are not a lot of planets with that valley. It was detected in radial velocity. It was not seen before in transit due first to the lack of detection of transiting planets at long period, and also to the problem due to the false positive. And when corrected from the false positive, we were able to detect again and to confirm the period valley, here the occurrence rate of planets as a function of the orbital period. And we are able, thanks to Kepler and Sophie, to confirm the period valley here, which was not seen before in a transiting planet. Maybe a last example of what we did with Sophie on a Kepler object. Here is at the case of KOI-142, which is a transiting super Earth with a period of about 11 days, which was detected with the Kepler. And in that system, it was huge TTVs, which is time transiting variations. That means that actually this is the period, but sometimes the transit was in advance, sometimes it was late. And actually here is a curve obtained by these authors of the delay or advance of the transit by comparison to that fixed period. And it shows, you see it's in minutes, so that means that, that sometimes the transit occurs 10 hours before it was expected and sometimes 10 hours later. And the variation is regular, as you can see. And so this author interpret that and the fact that there is another planet in the system perturbing that one, and we can detect that from transit timing variation. And they predicted that it should be so another planet, Kaoha, the planet C in that system, which have a period which is double of the one of the transiting one. So there is a resonance which do that the variation are huge, the TTV are huge. And they were able to predict the mass of the planet to slightly below the Jupiter mass. And so this planet is not transiting. It was not detected from transit of that planet in a Kepler-like curve, but it was detectable by radial velocity. So we observed it with the SOFI, and here are the results from SOFI. Actually, this is not a fit. Here are the radial velocity measurements from SOFI in red, and the sinusoid here is the prediction from the TTV. And as you can see, that match very well. So this is a case more or less similar to, it looked like the detection of Neptune by Le Verrier. He detected, he computes perturbation of Uranus. He predicted that there is another planet that could be detected by another technique, and it works. And it was about the same here, which is, of course, a very strong argument for the TTV study, which are not studies that are easy to do. So it's 12, so I think I will have to conclude soon. So I will switch about half of the transparency I was planning to show you and go to my conclusion, which are here. So the pioneering radial velocity method remained an efficacious technique to detect and characterize exoplanets. Now the radial velocity, we use them to increase the parameter space, so go to lower mass planets, longer period planets, and different kind of stars. And so about SOFI, now it reached an accuracy of 1 to 2 meters per second. So we can detect low mass planets around bright star with a 2 meter telescope. We can also detect and study larger mass planets even for fainter stars. Now we can say that SOFI contributed to the characterization, discovery and characterization of more than 150 planets. We continue to do radial velocity survey to our different types of stars. We continue to do follow-up in radial velocity of photometric survey, ground-based and space-based surveys. I didn't talk about obliquities. I planned to talk about obliquities. I didn't have time for that, so it will be, you can hear about that when Shweta will defend her thesis because she worked a lot on that. And SOFI also is planned to do on the TESS object. Maybe you heard about TESS, which is a new space telescope launched by NASA, and we already allow detection of discovery of planets. And now the field, the test field observable with SOFI will be soon on the sky. Also, we'll follow Plato and Cheops. And just to finish, I will end with a last observation done with SOFI, done by Alfred Vidal-Majar, David Ehrenreich, and other collaborators. David Ehrenreich, a former PhD student at IAP also. So during a moon eclipse, we observe the lights of the moon with SOFI. And it's very interesting because during a moon eclipse, we have the light of the sun that go through the atmosphere of the Earth. So by looking the lights of the moon, we can try to detect the signature of the Earth atmosphere. And here is the result of the spectrum observed with SOFI during a moon eclipse. And so we have the altitude of the species as a function of the wavelength. And there are several species detected here. There is the signature of ozone, the signature of dioxygen, the signature narrow one of sodium, and the slope here is the Rayleigh diffusion due to nitrogen. So of course, this is not a great discovery to conclude that these species are present in the Earth's atmosphere. We knew that before. But we observe them during a transit. And so say that maybe in 10 years, Plato will discover an Earth-like planet with 1 year orbital period around a solar type star, with transits once a year, so you should to wait for a transit. So maybe 10 years later, we are able to observe the transits, for example, with ELT, with a high accuracy, high resolution spectrograph, and people obtain this absorption spectra of an Earth-like planet transiting in front of the sun. And if they detect a spectrum like that, it will be, of course, a very interesting result, and I propose to conclude on that. Thank you very much.
S'il y a des questions.
So, thank you for your nice talk. I want to ask a statistical question. So, we have selection effects against seeing, in favor of seeing hot Jupiters. They're the easier things to find. And I remember a talk by Morbidelli, where he was saying that most of the stars actually have hot Jupiters. And so he was saying, if I understood correctly, so he was saying that our solar system is a rare object because we don't have a hot Jupiter.
I'm surprised he says that, no, because actually hot Jupiter are quite rare. The occurrence of hot Jupiter is slightly below 1%, something like that.
Okay, so I got it wrong.
Or maybe what he said is that the formation of hot Jupiter is very common, but most of the hot Jupiter, Jupiter mass planet, they migrate inside the system, they fell in the star, so they disappear, and actually just a few ones remain, slightly below 1%, and the question why the migration did stop is not so clear, actually. Mm-hmm. So maybe it was what you want to say, that maybe not the presence of Jupiter is common, but the formation of planets that eventually became hot Jupiter and then fell towards the star, that it could be more frequent, okay. Yes.
Just about the conclusions about the technique itself of radial velocity. So, of course, you concentrated on Sophie, but what are the perspectives on the technique? So to go below much more accurate.
By the way, I realize that I didn't tell you that there are also perspectives on Sophie in terms of instrumental, because we plan to change, we plan to change the detector, the fiber, in order to improve the sensitivity of the detector, its lifetime also. And so the perspective is to, yes, there are new, for example, now at VLT, there is a new Espresso spectrograph, which was just installed a few months ago. We just obtained an observation just a few weeks ago with that new instrument. So the goal for Espresso is to reach 1 to 10 centimeters per second accuracy. So to try to go, still continue to reduce that limit. So probably there will be issues with the stellar signals, but there are also issues with the instrumental, with the instrument itself. Another perspective is to go from the optical range to the infrared range, because it's very interesting to observe, to detect planets around M dwarf stars and even brown dwarf planets orbiting brown dwarf. And so, as you know, there are a lot of spectrographs that are developed right now to do such kind of measurement in the infrared, and in particular Spirou at CFHT, which will start his scientific observation in a few weeks or even in a few days.
So Guillaume, just to follow up, you mentioned HARP, and of course there are other telescopes that are using also the same techniques elsewhere in the world with SOFI-like spectrographs. So, obvious limitation for non-experts is that the 193-meter telescope at Haute-Provence is nowadays a modest-sized telescope. Yeah. So how far can such a telescope go? I mean, you mentioned progress, improvement, upgrades, and whatever. But what is the conceivable limit? Because
you know what?
There's a broader issue about the role of intermediate-sized telescopes on the telescope landscape in the world. So 2-meter telescopes are fairly common in many places. So give and take the site constraints, but what could be conceivably the performance we could say? And in a way, we could say, although this has to be interpreted lightly, that 150 planets is a small sample compared to the available thousands of planets that you have. So in terms of efficiency, in terms of breakthrough that such intermediate-sized telescope could give, what would be the niche in which this telescope could really bring an added value compared to the similar research conducted with higher diameter telescope?
So if I understood well, maybe the first point is why SOFIE is not as good as ARPS, maybe. So here there is a clear, no, but for example, clearly it's less accurate. So one difference is the telescope size, of course, so for depending on the stellar magnitude, it will change. And also, ARPS, intrinsically, it's more stable than SOFIE. A huge difference is the fact that the whole ARPS instrument is in a vacuum vessel, which is not the case for SOFIE. So different is the costs, of course. ARPS is by far more expensive than a SOFIE. And so we have variation in the instrument, in SOFIE itself, which are larger than in ARPS, but the point is to try to monitor this variation and to correct for them. So we correct for them, but not with a level of accuracy, which is a perfect, of course. About your point of the 150 planets by comparison with 4,000 planets that we know now, most of the planets known now were detected by Kepler. So Kepler is in transit, so it's a different technique, which of course it's very powerful. Kepler clearly was a revolution in exoplanetology because it provides a lot of information, but there are some limitations with that. First, with Kepler, you don't have the masses of the planets, and of course the mass of a planet is an important parameter to study it. Most of the planets detected by Kepler orbit around faint stars, so it makes difficult the follow-up studies to measure the mass, for example, but also to validate this is a planet, as I'll show you for the giant planet in the giant planet population, candidates detected by proposed by Kepler, about half actually are not planets. They are not included in the 4,000 planets. In the 4,000 planets, not of them were established to be actual planets with radial velocity measurements, but all of them were validated in terms of statistical arguments. So we're pretty confident with the sample of 4,000 planets. But for these 4,000 planets, there are a lot of information that are missing, and in particular, the mass. And the mass is a very important parameter.
I have a question, maybe in the following of this. Is when you speak of Kepler, and there will be TESS, Plateau, KEOPS, and particular tests and plateaus that are surveyed that will give a huge amount of system, or Gaia also, that is a survey that will give a huge amount of system. But when you make radial velocity, you just look to one star at a time. Is that right?
Yes, it is.
So I would think that in order to really improve things, instead of going to higher accuracy, maybe it would be to find a way to get plenty of spectrum at a time. Yeah. Is it possible?
So there are two kind of answers. First, when you talk about the survey mission, you talk about TESS, Plato, KEOPS. Actually, KEOPS is not a survey mission.
No. I didn't put KEOPS in the lot. I say TESS and Plato.
Yeah, but just to say that this is still pertinent to have more detailed analysis, more detailed studies on particular systems which are well identified to be interested. So that's what KEOPS does, and that's why also radial velocity measurement does. But still, your question, still there is a point here, and a way to do that in a more, to change of a dimension, it's to go to the, because we do survey actually, it's not only in radial velocity, most of my talk was on survey, but that's true that surveys in radial velocity will become less and less pertinent, I would say. Actually, large survey as we still do and has done for 20 years now, because there is a lot of result already obtained. But still it's possible to do such kind of measurement at high order of magnitude by doing using a robotic telescope. And there are some experiments, for example, our American colleagues have a telescope which is robotic, would do radial velocity measurement, so it changes the operation, of course, and we can construct a lot of them. So there are projects to do such kind of project. At OHP, I won't say it will be possible to make that telescope robotic. I don't think it will occur one day, so I think it will keep as it is now in terms of observation. Maybe we can think on long time scale, on maybe remote observation to do the observation slightly more efficient, but I don't think in terms of number of objects, with Sophie at OHP, there will be a revolution. But in radial velocity in general, yes, there are projects to do a robot, and there are already operating telescopes, robotic telescope to change the number of observations. It is important for programs as TESS and PLATO, which will require a lot of radial velocity measurements.
And what is the minimum size of the telescope to do that?
I will say 2 meters. With 2 meter telescope, we shown that we can obtain very good results, so on bright stars, but the future is on bright stars, because on faint stars, actually, we have the result already. It's the Kepler mission and Corot also. And now it's very important to obtain detection of planets, of transiting planets in front of bright stars in order to be able after to do follow-up studies, and in particular, studies of the atmosphere. And even for bright stars, study of the atmosphere, you will need a huge telescope from the ground as the ELT or such kind of telescopes.
Sophie has been in operation for more than 12 years. Do you try to detect a very long period star planets? In other words, are there stars that you have been monitoring for since the beginning with Sophie or even with Elodie?
Exactly. So we continue to do that. I show already some example with planets up to 10, and I show you an example of a planet with a 109 years period. So it's a very long, of course, we did not cover the whole period, but we use the LOD database. With Sophie, now it's 12 years. We use also archive data from other instruments, and we continue. Yes, we have such kind of program, and we'll do that also with the photometric surveys. I didn't talk about that. There are the monotransits. When you obtain, you detect an object with just one transit, and so you have a rough estimate of the period, but of course it's very inaccurate. So you need long-term radial velocity follow-up to characterize and to detect the period. And so there is a hope that some of the monotransit objects detected by TESS and later by PLATO will already have radial velocity measurements with Sophie and other radial velocity spectrograph to be able to follow on a long time scale such kind of variations.
Thank you very much. So I think we can make a last applause to the speaker. Thank you.